Good morning and welcome to Associated Hexagon, broadcasting on the Associated Transmitters of the Independent Broadcasting Authority. Tonight on ITV, police drama when two policemen hit the streets in Socier Oscar at 8:45.
You are this cow!
Vera's not happy with Beth with the latest on the cobbles in Coronation Street at 6:30.
You know you've no more morals you than a cat's behind.
And later, our feature film at 10:55, Flash Gordon. Will Flash save the day? Along with medical happenings in Cat Doctor Emergency at 8 o'clock and the news roundup at the news at 10. That's tonight on ITV. My name's Johnny Robinson. I'm a radio presenter and podcast producer, as well as everything in between, and I'm a complete utter TV geek. I love watching old adverts and idents and love critiquing them, so I thought I'd give this video a go. Now, firstly, I actually started making this video in 2018, and even though 2020 happened and some of us had quite a lot of time on our hands, it didn't really get a look in, and it needed a bit of a replan, but I've always wanted to go back and carry on with this project. So here I am, starting again, and we'll see how it goes. I've trawled through the boring, the weird, and the pretty cool, and if that's not a euphemism for spunking in the cinema, then I don't know what is. It's probably the closest they could get to popping the cherry during the daytime television. Cherry Coke is the best though, right? Yum. There's a massive myth about TV, and that is people saying, in my day, I only had four channels. Well, do you know what? That's complete rubbish. I want to do this to you. In 1982, yes, you had the launch of Channel 4. Hasn't changed. Yes, it was the fourth channel on terrestrial television, but there was already a bunch of community television experiments going on. There was also some other services such as British Relay. Cable television existed in the UK. I lived in Gloucester for a bit and I found this in my house. I had no idea what the hell it was until I found this video.
No carriage chimneys to be seen here. And inside, equally neat and unobtrusive, a modern wall socket and multi-pin plug. This is the key to trouble-free television and radio entertainment.
So what a flippin' heck was British Relay? Well, it had another name, which is Broadcast Relay Services, and they had shops like this.
We should have come to British Relay.
Looks so annoying to be around. So the idea was that they'd rent out a special box and maybe a special television that already could receive the signals. I mean, this is pretty cool. Pong built in onto your TV. That is the future.
We should have rented from British Relay.
Switch to British. You know, he's really thinking, oh no, should have bought a gun instead. Now, they even had local services on it, whether that was TV or radio. In Swindon, for instance, where I grew up in, there was one of the first in the country to have community television service, which launched in 1973, and it was called Swindon Viewpoint. But even before that, they had radio services on the channel as well. So it's been going for quite some time. I'm going to be looking at multi-channel TV, which really came into its own in the 90s. However, in the 80s, there was a lot going on. Fiber optics were being experimented on, and so was on-demand television. Actually, Westminster Cable had an amazing system that was available in the 80s, but it probably wasn't financially viable to do it until about 2010, maybe a little bit before that, to 2007, 2008, something like that. Plus, just imagine the complaints. Oh, you're digging up the road again and making a mess of the footpath!
Signal from my handset goes directly to the head end miles away, and a laser disc is put onto a turntable. It's like a video jukebox. Loading takes about 30 seconds, and remember, this is not a conventional video, yet only I see what's on my screen.
Look at those cutie little buddies! So bear in mind, a laser disc is probably about the same size as a record. They are quite big. I just have to say, I hope you do not have bird epilepsy. If you didn't, then you probably do now. I mean, we're living in the days now where on-demand television is at our fingertips, but it's just really annoying to think that we could have had it long before. You'll see in this video that where I came from, we were very special because we had not Vince Cable, not Deadpool Cable, we had something called Swindon Cable. Swindon Cable was a cable company set up in Swindon, obviously. If you were in Oxford, you couldn't get it because you weren't in Swindon. They'd tell you to right back off to Oxford, actually. It was doing community TV at the time when it first launched, and then it launched as a TV channel by Thorny MI and Radio Rentals kind of working together, and they continued their experiments. Basically, Swindon was becoming a place where they tested everything on, which is why, if you look for the secret tunnels in the town centre, they all lead to the Murray John Tower building, which is a special cockroach factory. By the 90s, other cable companies had a go. Those include Anglia Cable, Aberdeen Cable, Birmingham Cable, Cable London, Cable Midlands, Cable Northwest Liverpool, Bell Cable Media, Peterborough Cable Vision, and a fairly big one, United Artists, which ended up being Telewest. I'm going to get my Swindon Cable bit out of the way now. There was a wonderful local programme called This Is Swindon.
From the parks to Penhill, Wesley to Covingham, This Is Swindon. Every Wednesday, your area comes under the spotlight as we catch up with the week's top news stories and find out the latest about the town, the good and the bad.
So you can tell this man lives in Swindon because he knows there's bad. That's Paul Lancaster. He used to present a lot of the shows on Swindon Cable. And actually, I met him. I used to work with him at Swindon FM, which was a radio station on DAB a long, long time ago in Swindon. And way before I even met him, I already honed in on my Paul Lancaster impression.
This is Swindon's local channel, Channel 01 from Swindon Cable, bringing you a better local view.
I used to watch Swindon Cable all the time, so when I actually went to work at Swindon FM, it was like secretly meeting an idol, which I never actually told him. So, Paul Lancaster, if you've watched this video, hello. There was also a bunch of others like Cable 17 from Croydon Cable that had loads of local TV programmes on it. There was also Cable 7 broadcast in Leicester, and they also had a TV show called Despicable, which I have all the time in the world for this format. Have a look.
We are broadcasting live in Leicester right now as we speak. Don't put your arm on there, please. This is Despicable. It's just 6:30 now. It's Thursday night. No arms on there. This is mine, right? Okay.
What's the matter with you, eh? Do you got a problem or something?
Hey?
Do you got a problem?
Why are you going Marlon Brando on me?
Look, well, I'm sorry, but there's a bit of hostility in the air.
Don't come all innocent with me. You know it. Hark at the innocence of this man.
Oh, look, on the wall, a laser disc. Now, I'm about to say a bunch of channels in there in no particular order. I might miss some out, but I'm going to focus on the ones of the mid to late 80s and the early 90s TV stations. I was lucky enough to have both satellite and cable when I was a kid, so my experience with TV is a little bit different to other people, considering that not many people were able to get satellite around that time. And also cable, although I was in a good area for that, a lot of people didn't have that kind of stuff where they lived. For instance, I rarely had the four channel set up unless it was in my own room, and that wasn't until I was a teenager. To get cable, you had to have a little box like this. And I remember it was called Gerald because I used to talk to it, and its dad, or brand, was General Instruments. The vacuum cleaner, by the way, was called Goblin because it said Goblin on it. And also the TV said Pie on it, so its name was Pie. It was a very simple naming system. The second time we got Gerald, he didn't have his wooden coat on and he just looked like black. Bear in mind I was like six when this was the case. There was a number of local presenters on the station as well, who would tell you about events that was going on, or telly bingo at one point. The channel had space for local media groups and art shows and that kind of thing. During their downtime, they had something called Swindon Cable Vision, which was a bit like a PowerPoint, and also Sky Radio, which was nothing to do with Swindon, it was Dutch. In the early days, they actually did have local programming, and that stems way back to when it was just a relay service and there was a couple of spare channels on there, so they decided to do local radio. But even way before that, 1928, fun fact for you, there's been a service doing that all the way back since then. The fun fact they tell you on hospital radio. So here's your first proper channel. This is Cinematel. So firstly, if you like this bit of the video, then I strongly suggest you check out YouTube and look for Swindon Cable Television. It's where I've got the clips from, so yeah, have a look, it's really interesting. But Cinematel was the UK's first pay-per-view TV channel, and it showed movies. It only stuck around for a few years, but it was the first of many pay-per-view film channels, which I'll go into in a minute. Now, a lot of the channels were actually broadcast by a tape from the Head End. The Head End is the actual cable company itself, and what would happen is that they would produce the full night's programming on a tape that went out through the evening. Cinematel came from Swindon Cable Studios, which is just on the outskirts of the town centre going up towards Victoria Hill. But Swindon Cable would eventually move to its new HQ on Hawksworth Industrial Estate, right near the iconic Oasis Leisure Centre. This ident is kind of part of a running theme, because if you notice, all of the channels from cable and satellite kind of felt like you were watching them via like a satellite stuff going through space, knowing that space was a factor in your video viewing. It was just a bit weird. And a lot of the idents and stuff you'll see from this period do have stars, stuff flying through space, all that kind of stuff. Because Cinematel came from the same place as Swindon Cable's early operations, I've kind of bundled them together in this bit, because as for Thorn EMI, their channels, other than operating Swindon Cable, included launching the Entertainment Network with Mirror Newspapers, Screen Sport and Music Box. They also ran Swindon Cable until 1986, when they sold it to BT, who took away all the local programming and then brought it back in 1988. It then changed hands a few times and then was later renamed as Comtel in the late 90s, which was then bought by NTL and eventually rebranded to Virgin Media. There's a lot more about Swindon Cable. Like I said, have a look on YouTube and look for Swindon Cable Television, and you can find more clips about it on there. There's so much I could go into, but it was truly the localest TV you could get, more local than any ITV channel. Although Cinematel was long gone, which finished in 1984, the Swindon Cable service ran until the year 2000, when NTL promised that local programming would come back in the form of on-demand.
NTL took over the old Comtel franchises, including Swindon. They're now planning a new channel that will be delivered to customers through new technology known as video on-demand.
They lied. Wankers. Now, I just mentioned a bunch of stuff that Thorn EMI did, and one of those things is going into partnership with various other companies to form a channel. And the first channel they did that with was 10, the Entertainment Network.
The Entertainment Network presents the Movie Channel.
10, or the Entertainment Network, the Movie Channel, was a joint venture between Thorn EMI and the Mirror Group, aka Robert Maxwell. There's a whole story behind him. If you don't know who he is, do a quick search and you'll find his interesting past out. It was launched in 1984, and I think this Ident was voiced by John Peel.
In just a couple of minutes, a dreadful illness does not stop a young Italian boy striving for success in the swimming pool. That's Last Feelings.
Ten was on satellite, carried through cable, and I'm not sure if this was Robert Maxwell's like reaction to Rupert Murdoch's acquisition that he'd made a couple years ago, but the station shut down because only 10 people watched it, and it changed into Mirrorvision.
Starting tomorrow, we'll bring you a brand new service, the Brighter Mirrorvision Film Channel. All the major movies and more besides, the best from Mirrorvision.
At this point, they may as well rename themselves as Shit Films or Turds Television. Mirrorvision then, and again, led by Robert Maxwell, it showed pretty much the same thing as 10 did. You can find the full version of these on YouTuber Sid N's channel.
Hello, and welcome to afternoon entertainment with soaps, serials and classic films, all here on Mirrorvision's Matinee. You can catch up with the latest on Ryan's Hope in a couple of minutes. This afternoon's movie special is the British classic Your Money or Your Wife, starring Donald Sinden. That's followed at 3 o'clock by the continuing story of Power Without Glory. And today, John West has the police looking into his betting activities.
That's got to be the best warning that there is genitals coming up on your television, isn't there? Anyway, Mirrorvision didn't last that long because it became Premiere.
Good afternoon and welcome to Premiere at the start of our new April programme. We'd like to extend a special welcome to all our new subscribers who are joining us on the Rediffusion Network from today. Hello and welcome to Premiere.
The first of those clips was from its early days. It actually launched in 1984, and the latter was from nearer to its demise. Now, like I said, it launched in 1984, strangely enough, shortly after Cinematel finished. Premiere was also Thorny MI, and Robert Maxwell got in on it because all of the mergers, so that's how that happened. Now, another channel, Star Channel, would also merge with Premiere a few years later. However, Premiere would only stick around until 1989, and that's because Sky Movies launched in February 1989, so Premiere closed in July, ahead of losing any more money and viewers from the upcoming BSB channel. One of the things that actually made this channel worth watching was that it wasn't like the other ones, it actually had a bit of quality to it. HVC, the home video channel, also broadcast on tape. That was broadcast from the head end, but it was made by Croydon Cable. It showed B-movies including horror, sci-fi, action and erotica. It got sold to Premiere in 1987 and became a satellite channel via the Astra system. It would later get sold to the adult channel whilst increasing its sexy, sexy, sex, sex content, which, to be fair, puts another meaning to head end. Next up, Lifestyle. Now, I never got this sequence. Who even thought of it, and how do they pitch it? We'll go through a keyhole, and then an orange thing goes through a half a triangle, and then this TV looking thing comes up with a clock on it, but then one of the clock handles breaks off and then into a triangle, which is now a metronome. And now we go into the full logo, which is a weird shaped thing with some flying stars in the background. Doesn't make sense. And then that's when somebody said, hey, you know what women like, don't you? Butterflies. Wow, now they turned the girly levels up on this so high, it was positively period product advert levels. All those shades of pastel colours and the butterfly, I mean, come on, how more girly can you get? This butterfly either belongs on the front of a tampon box or on a doctor's surgery. Lifestyle was also part of the same group as Screensport at one point when it was sold to a company called WH Smith, known here in the UK as a stationery company. Lifestyle was their flagship station and its aim was a female audience. I suppose the whole ident is supposed to remind us that women need to be treated with care, like the delicate flowers they are. And if you've not detected the sarcasm, I'm hoping this is making it obvious. So yeah, that was Lifestyle, and when Lifestyle wasn't on, it was, because there was something called the Lifestyle Satellite Jukebox. Now this looks like it works how, if you remember the box before, it was like it is now, you used to ring them up and then select the track of the number. So this shared a transponder with Children's Channel. It was on from 10 o'clock tonight until 6 o'clock in the morning, and I think it's safe to say that this channel's target audience wasn't just women.
Bring me at home for a naughty chat on 0836 4022 89.
Meet someone the easy way. Ring Good Company on 0891 200 999. Listen to others seeking partners now on 0891 200 999.
Who chooses what you see on Lifestyle Satellite Jukebox? You can't choose if you don't call. Every night from 10 p.m. to 3 a.m. only on Lifestyle Satellite Jukebox, the channel where you call the tune.
The clips I've seen of this channel so far looks like it was always in 100% party mode, and so far I've not found any other clips of mainstream chart music. It was definitely a thing of its time. The music is quite dated. This got to number 10 in the Netherlands, which is quite surprising, but then, you know, this is the kind of thing you get on a year. There was boobs there, same transponder as Children's Channel, remember? I'll have to pixelate that now. Moving on. Hearing that puts me in a nice place, but I'll tell you what, before I go into this any further, I just want to say this sounds a little bit like Dreamer by Supertramp. One of the best kids TV channels in the world on a kid's point of view before Nickelodeon came along and derailed that train. But anyway, Children's Channel, it was owned by EMI and Flextech, who also owned some other channels such as Bravo Living, UK Gold, The Family Channel, Challenge and all that kind of stuff a little bit later on. Now, in its history, it purchased TVS's assets, including their studios in Maidstone when they lost the franchise for ITV. TV from Meridian. That's why the Family Channel used to have a lot of TVS shows, but that's more going into the 90s. Back to the Children's Channel, and it had shows from BBC, ITV, and its own programming. I used to watch The Magic Corner. There was also another show I used to watch on ITV. Everyone knows this one, Thomas the Tank Engine. It was also on Children's Channel too. And yeah, it was really cool. It also had shows from Europe. And this is where it gets a bit weird, because I actually thought this was a fever dream. And no, it was real. This is Telecat.
Here's our TV show, Telecat. Here's our TV show, Telecat.
Hi kids. Today, Hens Day the 5th, is Sugar Lump Day. Congratulations, all Sugar Lumps.
I've got so many questions. When's Hens Day? Does he have an arm or a hand, or is he an amputee? Like, what? What's going on?
Congratulations, Sugar Lumps.
Why does her neck not bend? Why has she got hands if she's probably got wings?
I know I had them here when I left. I wonder if some pickpocket dog stole them on the subway. Right, since I can't seem to lay my hands on that sugar, I'll ask Madam Spectacles.
Hello, what was that?
I want Madam Spectacles.
On the line.
Madam Spectacles, could you come up to the studio for a moment?
Oh dear, she reminds me of a horrid witch.
But she knows a lot. Sorry to trouble you, Madam Spectacles, but have you by any chance seen two lumps of sugar?
Yes. You left them in Mr. Whisker's office.
Oh, silly me. I went to look in the archives before the show.
And would there be anything else?
No, that was all, thanks.
As for you, my girl, you won't always be so proud.
What's she got against
Hold up
me?
A minute. Why she got breasts? Two lumps of sugar? More like two lumps of flesh.
My hump, my hump, my hump. My lovely little lumps. Check it out. I drive these brothers crazy.
Screen Sport was on cable and satellite, and it was a sports channel looking at sports across the world, including live European sport and highlighting other sports across the world. Thorny MI started winding down what they owned, and that included selling Screen Sport.
New Screen Sport is the European sports network, and it's under brand new management by WH Smith Television, one of Britain's largest communications companies.
Screen Sport's direct competitor was Eurosport. Yeah.
Sports fans will be on the ball with Eurosport. Our historic joint venture with the European Broadcasting Union.
And we could have a new world champion.
All the sports live from around the world.
Eurosport launched on the 5th of February 1989, the same day Sky launched Sky News, Sky One and Sky Movies. It was the only channel that wasn't Sky branded, although it was part of the network. It came about through a partnership with Sky and the EBU, that's the European Broadcasting Union, or Eurovision. It was an outlet for EBU's content and an overspill for Sky Sports programming that didn't fit on Sky. They didn't have their own Sky Sports channel at that point. So yeah, stuff like the WWF programmes that used to go on Eurosport. And also, Sky had been airing it since 1984 on the Sky Channel, so it's something they wanted to keep going. It wouldn't all be plain sailing, because Eurosport shut down for a time in 1991 after a dispute with Screen Sport and WH Smith Group, because they thought that EBU and Sky's partnership was restricting and distorting competition in the sports market. So it challenged it in court and it won. And then Sky threw its own birthday cake up the wall and left its own party. So the station said thanks for all the fish, they said goodbye, thanked everyone, and shut down like they were never coming back.
We're gathered here for a funeral today.
And if that wasn't a nail in the coffin, within 1 month, they would close down the BSB Sports Channel and open Sky Sports on its old frequency. But luckily, just before the worms burrowed in, Eurosport was saved by the ownership under the TF1 Group. And then pretty much on the same day as Sky Sports' launch, they were back. other than a few brake bumpers. The only difference between the two incarnations being the new Eurosport would have more pounding dance music behind everything, regularly using this song by Yellow, which is called The Race, in their startup and shutdown and in every bloody promo. Yellow probably made more money on the copyright than what Eurosport did from their sponsors. To be fair, it is a proper banger of a tune. In 1995, though, they gave up this and they would drop it for this instead. Bravo's next, and I couldn't find any original Bravo stuff other than the first original thing from Swindon Cable, and then some American idents, which kind of look the same, got the same kind of logo. But Bravo would start as a videotape service sent to the Head Ends in 1985, mainly played old films from the 40s and 50s, and it went to satellite in 1993, which is when these idents started being used. It was originally owned by United Artists, though, so it would make sense that if they had an American version, they just use the old idents on the British one. My memory of this channel was watching Norman Winston films. I knew who Mr. Grimsdale was. It gets all a bit Kurt Angle in the film Early Bird when he sprays his opponents with milk. Anyway, later Bravo changed hands a few times before being owned by Flextech in 1996, which we've already mentioned, and they changed tack, playing more sci-fi, horror and trauma films, and eventually became the channel you could rely on watching repeats of Booze Britain and Street Crime UK.
It's midnight in Swindon.
I used to watch it to see if my brother was on that day. He wasn't the police, just so you know. Next up is Music Box. It was a music channel seen as the British version of MTV, and it launched in 1984 from Thorn EMI, lasting until about 1987. The station was also broadcast on Yorkshire Television and also on the Sky Channel. It would later become part of Virgin Vision. It would broadcast as its own station until 1987, and then it would be taken over by Super Channel, and Music Box stayed on the channel until 1990.
It's here, the complete music service for your eyes and ears.
Music Box in stereo.
They would continue to make programmes for ITV, Channel 4 and Nickelodeon into the mid-2000s.
It's happening all over Europe, 18 hours a day, 7 days a week, in colour, in stereo, pop, quizzes, news and videos. It's enough to drive.
Through the night and through the week, Music Box. The fun starts now.
Its successor, Super Channel, was a joint venture with Virgin Vision, with Granada, Yorkshire Television, LWT, Central, Anglia, Tyne Tees, Ulster, Grampian, Scottish, Border, HTV, TSW and TVS, but not TVAM or Thames because they hated everyone else. The station was announced in 1985 in November, and it was planned to be a joint venture between the ITV companies and the BBC to challenge the Sky Channel, with TVAM in the morning. However, the BBC decided to take a back seat and would later venture into other stations in the 1990s, such as UK Gold, and they joined in with Thames. It did have some BBC shows along with ITN News and some other programming from other European channels. Sadly though, the Super Channel would start morphing into NBC in around 1993. For a time it kind of had the confusing schedule of business and music. In short, there was nothing worth watching and they knew it because their audience figures sucked. So did their bank accounts, hence why they got completely galumped by NBC. It was completely and utterly Americanized, and the only thing that actually remained European somewhat was the world news.
From the studios of ITN, the world news.
Hello, I'm Katie Haswell, the headlines.
NBC Super Channel would just then fizz off into non-existent, diluted into various media companies.
1 o'clock in Central Europe. Thank God for caffeine, that's all I can say. This is Music Television now on a Monday morning, or where is it? Well, are we on Mars or what? I said this coffee's strong. Are you sure it's coffee? I don't know. Here's Sinead O'Connor's Three Babies and a Horse.
MTV Europe launched in 1987, the European version had a lot of interesting competition with Music Box and the Power Station, and also Lifestyle Satellite Jukebox and also the Sky Channel. Unlike the other stations, there was a varying amount of different accents, and it wasn't UK-centric. MTV was more creative with its promos and idents. They were more slicker and more restrained and polished. However, the idents were probably just straight from America. In 1993, MTV Europe would end up buying the old TVAM studios after they lost the franchise. It's the European HQ of Paramount TV. It used to be called Viacom. And Channel 5 are currently based there. Local country versions of MTV would also launch in the late 90s, and that would include MTV Germany, MTV UK and Ireland, and a couple of others. However, MTV Europe will continue for countries that didn't have their own versions, and it would become MTV Global in 2022. For the next bit, I'm skipping over a bunch of stuff. However, if you want to find out more detail about what I'm talking about here, you can have a look for Bob the Fish's Square Peg series. But in short, this is BSB versus Sky. Technically, BSB just scrapes in here as far as the subject is concerned, because although they launched in 1990, their admin goes back to the 1980s, and also because their history is so connected with Sky, then it kind of makes sense to put them both together. Without going into too much information here, basically the IBA, who were the regulators, were not in charge of the pan-European Astra satellite system in the UK. Super Channel hadn't gained the traction British broadcasters had hoped for, and it was in the process of becoming shit. Plus, the other channels were, and here's that phrase again, pan-European. The government wanted a British system for primarily British audiences. It's become so British to pull out of a European thing now, hasn't it? Sky's existence caused an unthreatening problem for the government, and if someone else was to do it, then that would be a bigger problem. The problem was that their broadcasting satellites were across Europe, and it covered UK, so Sky was doing a Radio Luxembourg, basically. It was a legal pirate broadcaster, and there wasn't much the government could really do about it, because it was still keeping with the regulations to a different country in Europe. Now, talk about offshore broadcasting, this is pretty much off-planet broadcasting. But Sky was playing the game because they were on cable, and they considered the cable authority to be their regulator. Therefore, they stuck with the government official guidelines. Plus, this way, the government can't really have an argument against it, such as, it's dangerous to broadcast satellite signals, like they tried to say with pirate radio. Also, Rupert's friend Margaret was all up for this sort of thing, and she happened to be the Prime Minister. Everything had to be above board, though, so the franchise round was held to decide who would get the stamp of the approval of the British government in exactly the same way as ITV used to work. And by the way, in a nutshell, if you didn't know how that process works, basically, Yorkshire Television would say, I want to broadcast Yorkshire, and the government would say yes or no, as long as they gave them enough money. Or at least that's all it was in theory. It was a little bit more complicated than that. BSB were the winners of the IBA satellite franchise round, so they got to work challenging Sky. BSB also hoped to launch in 1989, but they weren't ready and they were beaten to air by Sky.
Satellite television has hit another hurdle, with the station BSB postponing its launch for at least 2 months. Already existing sales of Sky satellite dishes have been disappointing.
When BSB finally launched, it would include the movie channel. This Fill the Gap premiere left in 1989. It launched on the 25th of March 1990, and the channel stayed and evolved into Sky Cinema with the other film channels that would accumulate over the years. The Sports Channel, and that was just a big plethora of sports just on your TV. Not really interested in sports that much. However, I will say that in 1991, they changed the name of the Sports Channel to Sky Sports, as mentioned previously, with the whole Eurosport saga. The Power Station was a music channel on a similar lines to Music Box or MTV, but with a little more beef. more like a radio station, but in a studio on TV. Something that is back in fashion again at the moment. Chris Evans even presented a breakfast show, which was then get repeated in the evening.
Is this the presenter?
No!
Is this the presenter?
No!
Is this the presenter?
Yes!
Good morning! Yes, me too. Got stress?
No, I've got no stress!
And now, let's have a bit of self-raising flour.
Now, out of the channels to go, it was the last, and they were going to keep it, but Sky changed their mind.
Now, the Channel for Living has given television a new look. We've stripped the schedules to give people what they want to watch at the times they want to watch them.
Now, the Channel for Living was what you'd expect if BBC Five Live had babies with the Lifestyle Channel. It featured a mix of talk and chat shows with documentaries, news, current affairs, and art.
Of the rainforest disappearing, the world's greatest natural living resource falling victim to man's greed.
For many people, losing weight is such a problem that they need to get medical help.
In the countryside, waste is a cardinal sin. They make the best of what they've got.
Now was the first against the wall and shot at the first given opportunity. Now was then on the 1st of December 1990, a month after the merger and 9 months after the launch. Sky Arts was a thing and also was Sky News, but the Channel for Living was now dead. So much wordplay there, I hope you appreciate it. The biggest loss though was the flagship, Galaxy Channel. Was like the BBC One or Sky of the network, and its idents were refreshing. And if you look at the other idents around 1990, of what we were used to around the time, Galaxy Channel was the Waitrose to ITV's Quicksave. Even BBC One's Globe has nothing on this. Heck it, I'd even go as far to say that Galaxy's ident was better than Sky One's. And then not only that, their children's strand, Galaxy Club, had their own great idents. Galaxy Channel would be merged with Sky, meaning there would be no trace of the channel's existence going past the 2nd of December 1991. It would be forever remembered as that channel that once played that Hitler sitcom. But why did they merge with Sky in the first place? Well, for starters, they were struggling. They were late to get to air, they had issues with getting the kit for the people to receive their stations and the cost of the equipment to the consumer. But it wasn't easy sailing for Sky either. Satellite Television Limited launched in 1982. It was live from a small box on top of somebody's roof in London, and it transmitted by sending all of its signals via a wire to the moon and off to the satellite. I was lying about something there. Can you guess where it was? At this point, only a select few people would have been able to afford the equipment to pick the channel up. It was struggling, but mogul Rupert Murdoch saw an opportunity, probably inspired by Ted Turner, the American media mogul. Murdoch renamed Satellite Television Limited to Sky. Sky Channel would be the pioneer broadcasting across Europe. Murdoch pretty much threw money at it until it worked, and although I'm not a fan, he pulled off some masterstrokes in marketing.
Ooh, Gary Davey. Ooh, Gary Davis.
The Sky Channel would embrace Europe in its beginnings, not specifically focusing on the UK, but with it being a part of its broadcast. It was the first time we'd get to see adverts from different countries pumped into our eyes too.
It's morgens viel trockener, und darüber sind wir beide sehr froh.
Pampers hält Babys trockener, gerade wenn sie es am meisten brauchen.
Sky may have been broadcasting to 10 people on satellite in 1982, but then that became 11 in 1983, when it launched on Swindon Cable. The Sky Channel would join other cable networks after its fifth birthday in 1987. Sky had a completely different look to the other channels at the time. Music Box would fill up a lot of its airtime at one point, but Music Box would also be on other channels. And once they were fully broadcasting, they introduced Sky Tracks. To be fair, much of Sky's early output was music shows, mostly hosted by former Radio 1 or Radio Luxembourg presenters. Sky would bring us some huge future icons to TV, such as WWF Wrestling and The Simpsons. Sky Channel will become Sky One in 1989, along with the launch of the Sky Network, which would consist of Sky One, Sky News, Sky Movies and Eurosport. I've already mentioned them, so don't have to carry on. It should have included the Disney Channel, but that fell through and would eventually arrive later. Underneath all those, Sky was struggling and neither Sky or BSB were winning audiences. So, they both decided to merge. This also solved that little niggle of Sky not being regulated, because as part of BSB, they were. Shortly into the 1990s, Sky would replace BSB's Now channel with Sky Arts, change BSB's Sport channel to Sky Sports, launch and then close the Comedy channel, and add Sky Movies Gold to the old Galaxy channel. They would also launch Sky Multi channels, adding some other stations to their subscription deal, and go into ventures with Scottish Television and Granada. As for pan-European broadcasting, that would continue, but the other broadcasters following Sky's lead, focusing on their own countries rather than a large area of Europe, which made sense as far as advertising went, because filling up your advertising space with Raider and Yankee bars wasn't going to sit well in the UK, especially because you couldn't buy them. Similarly, you couldn't justify Thora Hird selling Santa Stelliffs to the Dutch, as it would have been a fair trek to get to Hoofddorp. In the next episode, I'll be looking into satellite and cable in the early 90s. That's it for now. I've been Johnny Robinson, and I'll still be Johnny Robinson after this video is finished. Thank you, bye. Cheer you up, cheer you up, cheer you up in a bin-up club. Cheer you up, cheer you up, cheer you up in a bin-up club. La, la.